During the first concert of the music of Lou Harrison and I Am He, we heard some of my early works and what I like to call my mission period works, which were a result of being a Californian primarily. During the present concert, I would like to present to you some of the works that I have written for the more generalized concert-going public. They are therefore from works that are quite large in size, in terms of length of time they play, and for larger ensembles. From my suite for symphonic strings, as recorded by the string section of the Louisville Symphony Orchestra, I would like to present movements 1, 2, and 3. This suite is composed out of a great number of pieces which were not related to begin with, but all of a sudden one key piece sort of fell into place and I made a larger work out of it. Then I found, after I had assembled the pieces, that the entire work needed to have revisions made in separate pieces, so that I spent a great deal of time altering individual pieces in relation to the entire piece. As a result, there is a note at the beginning of this work in the score which says that you can play any 3 consecutive pieces of it, but you can't select 1, 6, and 8, let's say. You can play any 3 consecutive pieces if you don't want to play the entire work. We will hear then the first movement, which is based on medieval estampilla ideas. The second movement, which introduces a slightly dramatic scheme for the work, the idea of death and a chorale. It is headed by the quote of "Et in Arcadia ego," meaning "I am even in Arcady." Death, of course, is even in Arcady. Then this third movement is the earliest work that we are hearing of mine on any of these concerts, and I wrote it when I was 17. It's a double fugue for the full string orchestra. So the first movement is an estampilla, the second movement a chorale, and the third a double fugue from my suite for symphonic strings.
Thank you.
For many years, I worked on a symphony which is composed in the 12-tone idiom. It is a standard operating procedure in this century and became even more so after the Second World War. I had started this symphony a long time ago. It's all composed on a single row and makes use of a variety of techniques which I had regarded at the time as my own invention, including the a new last movement. It is called Symphony on G, although it is a serial piece, by reason of the fact that it is tonally centered on the tone G, not that it plays scales, because of course it doesn't. It's in four movements. However, the scherzo, the third section, is in itself four movements. It is a suite. And this idea I derived from the symphonic concept of a scherzo with trio, or a minuet with trio. Already you have there two little musical forms. I simply expanded this, because the size of the symphony warranted it, into a suite, so that the entire structure of the composition runs. First movement, allegro, and it's a vigorous preludizing kind of thing. Then a largo, this is the second movement, lyrical in nature. Then the fourth movement, the scherzo, is divided into four movements. They are, let's see, waltzes, yes. Waltzes come first, then a polka, then an air, and then a little rondo in which the orchestration is reduced only to a harp, a tack piano, and a piano. This makes a kind of cadenza for the entire symphony. And out of that little rondo, then, there's a big rondo, which is for the entire large orchestra. And the so that the fourth movement third movement, rather, is four movements in itself. Then there is, of course, a finale at the end, which is larger in size. My Symphony on G.
Yeah.